Hello everyone. So in the last lecture we have done the hypothalamus gland. We have seen the differences between the nervous system and the endocrine system and how do they function for the carrying out the different coordination between the systems. Okay. Now let's start the second type of hormone, which is the pituitary gland. Okay, so we are done with the hypothalamus. Now we'll be starting with the pituitary gland. Okay. Now pituitary gland is considered to be the smallest gland. It is considered to be the smallest gland. Okay, let us see the structure first of all. So pituitary gland is considered to be the smallest gland, smallest endocrine gland, and also called as hypophysis cerebri. And it was the term was given from the Vesalius. Okay. And it is ectodermal in origin. Now this is called as master gland. As we know that the hypothalamus gland was called as master gland because the hypothalamus would be regulating this pituitary, and this pituitary is again regulating different glands present in the body, and hence it is called as master gland. Okay. Next, it is called as master gland, or it can be called as leader of the endocrine orchestra, or we can say chief executive of endocrine system. So there are different endocrine glands which are under the regulation of pituitary gland. There are different type of endocrine glands which will be under the regulation of this pituitary gland, and hence this pituitary gland is also called as master gland, or we can say leader of endocrine orchestra, while it is also called as chief executive of endocrine system. Now it is situated at the floor of diencephalon in cella turcica. So diencephalon is a part of the forebrain. Okay, so it is basically present at the floor of the diencephalon, and in the cavity, this cavity is called as cella turcica, and it is attached to the hypothalamus by a stalk. So here we can see this is the hypothalamus, and this is a stalk which is basically connecting it, and this is the pituitary gland. Okay, this is a stalk which will be connecting this hypothalamus to this pituitary gland. Now this pituitary gland will be having two structures, that is the anterior one, which is called as anterior pituitary, while the second, the posterior one, which is called as posterior pituitary. So anterior pituitary and the posterior pituitary, in that sense there are two structures associated with the pituitary gland. Okay. Now the structurally the pituitary gland is divided into two parts. Called as anterior pituitary. This is the one which is anterior pituitary and the posterior pituitary. This anterior pituitary plus intermediate lobe. Okay, this anterior pituitary and this intermediate lobe is also called as adenohyperphysis. This is the anterior pituitary and this intermediate lobe is called as adenohyperphysis, while this posterior pituitary is called as neurohypophysis. Okay, so we have seen the smallest gland term was given by Vesalius. Okay, an ectodermal origin called as master gland or leader of endocrine orchestra. It is situated at the floor of the diencephalon in cella turcica and attached to the hypothalamus by a stalk. Now it is homologous to the Hermannia subneural gland and amphixious Miller organ. Okay, so that's not required actually. Now we can see it is attached to this hypothalamus with the help of this infundibulum. Okay, and this is a posterior lobe, this is anterior lobe plus middle lobe will be forming this adenohyperphysis, while this posterior lobe will be forming this neurohypophysis. Okay. Now these substructures will be again divided into two parts. The structures will be again divided into three parts. That is, the adenohyperphysis will be consisting of pars distalis, pars intermedia, and pars tuberalis. Okay. So adenohyperphysis will be again divided into three parts. That is, the pars distalis, pars intermedia, and pars tuberalis. Okay. While the neurohyperphysis, that is posterior lobe, consists of again three parts. It will be pars nervosa, infundibulum or stalk of pituitary gland. This is the pars nervosa. Okay, infundibulum or stalk of stalk, and this media eminens or tuber cinereum. Okay, so these three parts, the infundibulum, tuber cinereum or posterior lobe, is basically part of the neurohyperphysis, and anterior lobe, middle lobe, and pars tuberalis is the part of the adenohyperphysis. The adenohyperphysis is basically consisting of three parts, while the neurohyperphysis will be consisting of these three parts. Okay, so let us discuss each of them one by one. Now let us start with the adenohyperphysis. So adenohyperphysis is originated from the Rathke pouch of stomatium. And it will be secreting six hormones mainly. six hormones. Those are the growth hormone, and then the thyroid stimulating hormone, then the follicle stimulating hormone, luteinizing hormone, prolactin, and ACTH, that is adrenal corticoid tropical hormone, adrenal corticoid tropic hormone. These are the six hormones which are secreted through the adenohypophysis. These are the six hormones secreted through the adenohypophysis. Now the growth hormone plus prolactin are secreted by acidophils or cells. Okay, we can say the growth hormone plus prolactin. These are the two which are secreted by the acidophil cells. TSH, FSH, luteinizing hormone, adrenocortical tropic hormones, these are secreted by the basophil cells. And chromophils are the precursors of the end cells. Okay. Now, the chromophils are the precursor of alpha and beta cells. Alpha and beta cells. Okay. So, he can say the growth hormone and prolactin are secreted by acidophils or alpha cells. So, you may note it down. It's alpha is not written over here. So, growth hormone plus prolactin. Growth hormone and this prolactins are secreted by acidophils, or we can say alpha cells. So this will be consisting of, the adenohypophysis will be consisting of three types of cell, alpha, so two types of cell, that is alpha and beta cells. So the growth hormone will be this growth hormone and this prolactin. These are the two hormones secreted by the acidophils, or we can say alpha cells. These are the one which will be stained by the acidophilic dyes. Okay, so they are alpha cells. Then TSH, thyroid stimulating hormone, follicle stimulating hormone, luteinizing hormone, adrenal corticoid tropic hormone, these are the hormones which are secreted by the basophils, or we can say beta cells. While the chromophils are the precursors of both alpha and beta cells. Chromophils are the precursors of both alpha and beta cells. Okay. Now, hormones of adenohypophysis. Hormones of adenohypophysis. What are hormones are basically secreted through by the adenohypophysis? They are, first one is the growth hormone, or we can say anterior lobe of pituitary. So the first one is the growth hormone. Growth hormone, or we can say somatotropic hormone. Someto means the something related to the body part. So it's a growth hormone is also called as somatotropic hormone, or we can say STH, somatotropic hormone, or we can say STH. It is proteinaceous in nature. We have seen the different nature of the hormones on the basis of their chemical nature. So it's a proteinaceous nature. So we know that the proteinaceous nature hormone will be having the membrane bound receptor present on the cell membrane, right? So these are the growth hormone which will be having, which is proteinaceous in nature, and will be having membrane bound receptor present in the cells. Mostly it will be present in almost of the cells. Now these are responsible for stimulating the cell division. These are responsible for stimulating the cell division and act on the epiphyseal plate of bone. So bone increases in length, so height also increases. So these are the one which will be acting on the epiphyseal plate of bone. This is the terminal part of the bone where the bone growth will be regulated. Okay, so they will be acting on this epiphyseal plate, and so the bone will increase and the height of the person or the individual will also increases. Okay, so it is responsible for the growth of organism, hence it is called as growth hormone. Okay, it stimulates the gluconeogenesis. It means it will be responsible for formation of new glucose. It will be responsible for formation of new glucose through different other intermediates. Okay, so this process of formation of new glucose, neo means the new, genesis means formation. So the formation or the synthesis of the new glucose is called as gluconeogenesis. It also helps in glycogenesis, where the glycogen is basically formed, okay, with the help of higher amount of glucose, and it stimulates the lipolysis, or we can say the fats which are present as a stored material will be oxidized in this condition. Okay, and also responsible for the synthesis of protein. In this way, it will be stimulating the physical growth of an organism. So it is responsible for different type of chemical pathway which would be leading to the growth of organism, like the gluconeogenesis, glycogenesis, stimulating the lipolysis, and also the protein synthesis. Okay, so now let us see the effects of the growth hormone, effects of the excess of growth hormone. So many time what may happen, the person will be basically showing high amount of growth hormone present in the body, so under that condition it would be leading to the formation of a gigantism in childhood. So in this condition what will happen, below the 18 years, and the person will be secreting high amount of growth hormone. So below the 18 years in the child particularly, it will be secreting the high amount of growth hormone. We can say over secretion of growth hormone will take place, due to which it will be responsible for the abnormal growth of the body. It will be responsible for the abnormal extra large growth of the body. Such condition is called as gigantism. And it is basically found in the childhood. It is basically observed in the childhood. Second is the acromegaly. is basically the condition of extra growth of one body parts during the adult condition, during the adult form. Okay, so acromegaly is basically considered to be the condition where the extra growth of an organism will take place in adulthood. Okay, so over here the organism will be showing the gorilla like organ, that is the enlargement of hand and feet. The enlargement of hand and feet will take place, and the nose and the lower jaw are also lengthened. So over here the feet and the palms get basically enlarged. Okay, and the nose will be also enlarged, and the lower jaw of the body of the mouth will also be enlarged. Okay, so this condition is found in the adults and called as acromegaly. While such type of condition, enlargement of the body parts or the large growth of a body in the childhood is called as gigantism. Okay, now this was about the excess of growth hormone. While sometimes there will be the deficiency of growth hormone also. So during the deficiency of growth hormone, it will be responsible for causing different conditions. It will be responsible for causing different condition. That is, first is the pituitary dwarfism. So dwarfism is the stunted growth of the body. So when the low secretion of growth hormone take place, so when the hormone will be released in a small amount, so when we say it is not present in sufficient amount, when the growth hormone is not secreted in sufficient amount, then the stunted growth will be taking place. So stunted growth will be seen when the body will be secreting lower amount of growth hormone. So when the lower amount of growth hormone is secreted, it will be responsible for the dwarfism, where the patient's IQ is normal, but they are called the midgets or circus joker, and they are basically sterile. They are basically called midgets. They are called midgets, and they are sterile in nature. They will not be able to produce the child. They will not be able to produce the offspring. Okay. Second is the Simon's disease. This is found mainly in the adult female. This is mainly found in the adult female, and it is again due to the lack of the secretion of growth hormone. And at the time of delivery, excessive bleeding may occur, due to which the blood supply to the adenohyphysis decreases. So due to the time of delivery, what may happen? The blood supply to the adenohyphysis decreases due to the excessive bleeding. Okay, this will be leading to the condition called as Simon's disease. Okay, and next one is the. Okay, so that was about the hormones which are released from the different disorders which are basically concerned due to the excess of growth hormone, or you can say deficiency of the growth hormone. So that is about the growth hormone secreted by the adenohyphysis. Next is the thyroid stimulating hormone, the other hormone which is released by this adenohyphysis or the anterior pituitary lobe, is the thyroid stimulating hormone, or called as TSH, or it is also called as TSH. Okay, now the TSH stimulates the thyroid follicles. The thyroid gland has got specifically cells called as follicles, which are responsible for secretion of thyroid hormone, that is thyroxine. Okay, so what happens? These follicles are under the regulation of the hormone called as TSH, that is thyroid stimulating hormone. So this TSH will be stimulating this thyroid follicle to secrete thyroid hormone, which affects indirectly called as calones, which will be affecting indirectly, and such hormones which is affect indirectly is called as calones. The hormones which are affecting, which shows the effect indirectly is called as calones, while the hormones that shows the effect directly are called as autoimmunes. So there are two types of hormones, autoimmunes and the calones. What are autoimmunes? Autoimmunes are those hormones which shows the effect directly. Autoimmunes are those hormones which will be showing the effect directly, like growth hormone, insulin, epinephrine, etc. While the calones are those hormones which will be showing the effect indirectly, that is TSH, ACTH and ICSH. It is thyroid stimulating hormone, ACTH and ICSH, etc. So that is about the thyroid stimulating hormone. The source is the pituitary gland, anterior lobe, while the target organ is the thyroid. Okay, it will be stimulating the follicles of the thyroid to stimulate the secretion of the thyroxine. Next is ACTH, adrenocorticotropic hormone. It's a long peptide hormone which stimulates the adrenal cortex to release the adrenocorticoid. Now this adrenal cortex is present on the kidney. So which will be releasing the adrenocorticoids, and this will be stimulated under the presence of a long peptide hormone called as adrenocorticoid.
corticotropic hormone, which is secreted by this anterior part of the pituitary, and it will be also secreting this. It will be also affecting indirectly. It's also infecting indirectly, and hence it is called as calones. It will be also called as calones. Okay. Now it will be also secreting the gonadotropin. Gonadotropins are the one which are responsible for stimulating the gonads. Gonads are the male and female reproductive glands. That is the testes in the case of male, and in the case of female, the ovaries. Okay. So these are the hormones which will be stimulating the secretion of the hormones from the reproductive glands. These are the hormones which are responsible for stimulating the secretion of the hormones from the gonads, that is reproductive structures of the male and female. So these are mainly luteinizing hormone, or we can say LH, or we can say follicle stimulating hormone. Okay, they are responsible for stimulating the gonadal activity, and indirectly they will be responsible for secretion of the testes and ovum as well, formation and secretion of the testes and ovum development. Okay, so they are mainly responsible for secretion and the development of the male and female gametes, that is sperm and the ovum, directly or indirectly. Okay, next is FSH, follicular stimulating hormone. So gonadotropins can be of two types, that is luteinizing hormone and the FSH, that is the follicular stimulating hormone. Let us discuss each of them one by one. So FSH is also known as follicular stimulating hormone. In male, it stimulates the spermatogenesis. In the case of male, it will be stimulating the spermatogenesis by acting on the testes, that is the acting on the male reproductive structures. Okay. So in the case of male, it will be stimulating the spermatogenesis, while in the case of female, it will be stimulating the oogenesis. It will be stimulating the oogenesis, that is the formation of ovum. Okay, while in the case of male, it will be stimulating the spermatogenesis, that is the formation of the sperms. Okay. Second, the luteinizing hormone LH. In the male, it is called as ICSH. Note it down. In the case of male, the luteinizing hormone is called as ICSH, that is interstitial cell stimulating hormones. The name itself suggests that it will be responsible for stimulating the cells present between the seminiferous tubules of the testes. Okay, so in the case of male, it is called as ICSH, that is interstitial cell stimulating hormone. It stimulates the synthesis and secretion of hormone called as androgens from the testes. So it is the one which is responsible for synthesis and secretion of the hormones called as androgens from the testes. And it also stimulates the Leydig cells. It stimulates the Leydig cells, that is interstitial cells, to secrete testosterone. So this testosterone and this androgens are both male reproductive hormones. Okay. So it stimulates the interstitial cells. It stimulates the synthesis and secretion of hormone, that is androgen, from the testes. And it also stimulates the Leydig cells, that is interstitial cells, to secrete the testosterone. In the case of females, it is responsible for ovulation of fully mature follicle. In the case of females, we were seeing that oogenesis and the spermatogenesis in the another whole different chapter. But right now we can understand that luteinizing hormone in the case of male is responsible for the secretion of testosterone and androgens, while in the case of females, it is responsible for the ovulation of fully mature follicle. Okay. It is also responsible for rupturing of graafian follicle. It's the it's again a stage of the oogenesis. Okay. So the formation of corpus luteum, and corpus luteum secretes the progesterone. So it is also responsible for the formation and the rupturing of this graafian follicle, and formation of corpus luteum and the secretion of the progesterone. Prolactin, also called as milk synthesizing hormone, which is also secreted by the anterior part of the pituitary gland. And it is also called as milk synthesizing hormone, which stimulates the milk synthesis in mammary gland. It stimulates the milk synthesis in the mammary gland, and also found in the birds. Next is the melanocyte stimulating hormone, that is MSH. It is again a long peptide hormone, which acts on the melanocyte and regulates the pigmentation of the skin. Melanocytes are those cells of the body, particularly found in the epithelial region, which are responsible for secreting the melanin pigment. And this melanin pigment is responsible for the darkening of the skin. So it protects the skin or the body from the harmful rays of the sun, that is UV rays. Okay. So this melanin will be synthesized higher amount in the presence of the sunlight,
while in the absence of sunlight, it will be not present. It will be present in lower amount. Okay. So the melanin secretion is basically regulated by the hormone called as MSH, that is melanocyte stimulating hormone, which is secreted from the anterior part of the pituitary gland. Okay. So it's a long peptide hormone, acts on the melanocyte and regulates the pigmentation of the skin. In normal condition, it is not confirmed that it is secreted or not secreted, but in Addison's disease, ACTH, this is a specific type of disorders of the ACTH, increases and the MSH increases, so cause hyperpigmentation, that is called as bronze skin. So here these are the hypothalamus. The hypothalamus will be responsible for, will be acting on the pituitary gland. Okay, and then it will be responsible for the different other structures. Okay, so we have seen the different hormones secreted by the anterior part of the pituitary, also called as adenohypophysis, which are basically responsible for the secretion of the TSH, that is thyroid stimulating hormone, then the FSH, follicle stimulating hormone, then the growth hormone is also there. ACTH is the adrenocorticotropic hormone, prolactin is there, LH is there, FSH is there, and then the MSH. So these are different hormones which are secreted from the adenohypophysis or the anterior part of the pituitary gland. Next is the neurohypophysis. Next one is the neurohypophysis. So it is a posterior lobe of the pituitary gland. And it is formed by the extra growth of the diencephalon. Okay, so diencephalon is the part of the forebrain which will be growing, showing an extra growth, which is called as neurohypophysis. Now it will be responsible for secretion of two hormones, that is oxytocin and ADH. Oxytocin and ADH, that is the antidiuretic hormone, or also called as vasopressin. So it is responsible for secretion of two hormones, that is oxytocin and ADH, that is antidiuretic hormone, or we can say vasopressin. These both are synthesized in the hypothalamus. This is something you have to keep in mind. So this ADH and this oxytocin, although they are secreted through the pituitary gland, but they are synthesized in the hypothalamus. Okay. And comes into the neurohypophysis through the axons. So they will be basically synthesized over here in the hypothalamus, but will be released to the neurohypophysis part, or again the posterior part of the pituitary through the axon. Okay. So the oxytocin will be synthesized inside the hypothalamus and comes into the neurohypophysis through the axons. Now this oxytocin synthesized in a supraoptic nuclei, and ADH synthesized in the paraventricular nuclei. These are the parts of the hypothalamus or nuclei is the center through which these hormones are synthesized. Okay, so the oxytocin will be synthesized in the supraoptic nuclei. While the ADH will be synthesized in the paraventricular nuclei. Okay, now let us see the hormones of the neurohypophysis will be consisting oxytocin. It is also called as pitocin. Mostly the pitocin will be the artificial synthesized form, but still the oxytocin is also called as pitocin. Oxytocin is also called as the milk ejecting hormone because it helps in the milk ejection. Okay, so prolactin was the one which was responsible for the formation of milk. Okay, the prolactin was the hormone which was responsible for the formation of the milk in the mammary glands of the females. Okay, while the oxytocin, that is pitocin, is the one which is responsible for the ejection of this milk. And it also helps in the nourishment of the infant. Okay, and also called as birth hormone, because it has got a very important role during the parturition of the baby. Okay, so oxytocin's main role of or main function of the oxytocin includes, it mainly responsible for contracting the smooth muscles of upper segment of uterus, and so that the baby can be delivered easily during the parturition. So it is responsible for the contraction of the smooth muscles of the uterus. Okay. And parturition is a normal physiological process which is mainly done by the oxytocin. So oxytocin is responsible for the contraction of uterus and hence responsible for carrying out the parturition. Okay. Next, here you can see deficiency of these hormones will be ADH. ADH is not seen. Let us see. So ADH is basically antidiuretic hormone, or we can say it's also called as the vasopressin. So antidiuretic, the name suggests it is diuresis, means the meaning of diuresis is to release the urine, to pass out the urine. Okay, so it is the one which is basically preventing this release of urine. That's why it is called as antidiuresis. The main function of this hormone is to retain the water. It's to retain the water or to prevent the water loss. It is, the main function is to prevent the water loss. So it is important to to retain the water inside the body. It is important for the retaining the water inside the body, and hence it is important for increasing the blood volume. It is important for increasing the blood volume and hence blood pressure. As because it is responsible for increasing the blood pressure in the blood vessels, it is called as vasopressin also. It is also called as vasopressin, which is pressurizing these vessels. Okay. So ADH will be basically working under the effect of when the blood volume rises up. Okay, the blood volume will rise up. The ADH will be low. When it is, the blood volume will be low, the ADH will be high. Okay, so this will be regulated accordingly, according to the blood pressure particularly, and according to the concentration of the solutes and the water in the blood. And deficiency of the ADH will lead to the deficiency of ADH causes the diabetes insipidus. Diabetes insipidus is a condition where the person will be releasing the water in very high amount and will have to go for the urination again and again frequently. Okay, and hence the water will not be retained in the body improperly. Okay, so deficiency of ADH will be responsible for causing the diabetes insipidus. Okay, it is different from the diabetes mellitus, where the person will be suffering from the hyperglycemic condition. Okay, here it will be basically carrying out, it will be releasing the water again and again in the form of urination, and the body will not be able to retain the water for a longer duration. So polyuria, it will be also leading to the polyuria, that is increase in the urine output. Polydipsia, increase in the take of water, because the water will be removed out at a very frequent rate. So at the same time, the uptake of the water will be also increased, and hence the person will be feeling thirsty again and again, and such condition is called as polydipsia. So polyuria is the increase in urine output, while the polydipsia is the increase in uptake of the water. In this is the urine output is around 10 liter per day. That's much more than the normal output would be, which would be around 1 to 1.5 liter. Okay, and normal output is 1.5 liter per day, but in the case of polyuria, that is diabetes insipidus, the person will be releasing out around 10 liter of the urine per day. Okay, so that was about the hormones which are basically released from the pituitary gland, both the part, that is anterior and the posterior. Next gland is the pineal body. Okay, now the pineal body it originate from the exoderm and formed by the ependymal cells and glial cells. Okay, so the origin of the pineal body is exodermally and formed by the ependymal and the glial cells of the body. Previously it was called as vestigial third eye. But now confirmed to be the endocrine gland. Previously it was believed to have no any functional significance. But now it is confirmed that to be the endocrine gland. Mainly the cavity where it is present is called as cyclostomata. Now present behind the epithalamus and the roof of the encephalon. So it is just present behind the epithalamus and the roof of the encephalon on dorsal side of the forebrain. It secretes a hormone called as melatonin. Which is antagonist of melanin. It means it will be acting against to the melanin. Melanin is basically responsible for pigmentation of the skin. So it will be causing the opposite effect of this melanin. Okay, hence it will be preventing the pigmentation, for which the synthesis of tyrosine amino acid is required. So it is responsible for secretion of melanin. It is responsible for secreting the substance called as melanin, hormone melatonin, which is requiring the tyrosine amino acid, which requires the amino acid tyrosine as a precursor or the raw material. Okay, and as the melanin will be responsible for darkening of the skin, melatonin is responsible for light, making the skin color light, will be responsible for making the skin color light. And it inhibits the gonadal function. So it will be acting against the gonadal function as well, and remain active up to 7 years after the birth. It will be remaining active only up to the 7 years after the birth. Okay, so up to the 7 years, the gonads of the individual are not developed. due to the presence of the melatonin. Okay, so melatonin will be acting against the melanin. Okay, and it will be responsible for lightening of the skin, and it will be also inhibiting the gonadal function. It will be also inhibiting the gonadal function and would be remaining active up to around 7 years after the birth. Okay, up to the 7 years after the birth. So once the pineal body get inactivated, once the pineal body gets inactivated, the puberty may start. The puberty may start after the inactivation of the pineal body only, because the puberty would be marked by the development of the sexual characters or the gonads. Okay, so this pineal body will be inactivated, and hence we can say the gonads will be starting to develop. So after the inactivation, the calcium salt get deposited in it, which is called as brain sand. So once the pineal gland is getting inactivated, the calcium salt will be deposited in it, and it is called as brain sand. And this is brain sand is also called as acer villi. This is also called as acer villi. Okay, so what happens? The pineal gland gets inactivated and will lead to deposition of the calcium salt within this pineal body, which is called as brain sand or acer villi. Acer villi. Now, melatonin plays a very important role in the regulation of the 24 hour diurnal rhythm of the body. So it's important for the maintaining the diurnal cycle. So you would be seeing that once we feel, once the night comes, once basically the darkness occurs in the night, we may feel sleepy. Okay, when the morning, during the morning, when the sunlight occurs, sunlight is basically present, we feel wake up. Okay, so that cycle is basically regulated by the body alarm. Okay, that is called as diurnal cycle. Okay, so it is, the melatonin plays a very important role in regulation of this 24 hour rhythm of a body. In addition, this melatonin is also influencing the metabolism of different compounds. Okay, pigmentation of the body, the menstrual cycle, as well as defense capability. So it is responsible for different other function, the process as well, like the metabolism of the cells, pigmentation of the body cells, okay, the menstrual cycles in the females, while the defense capability of the human body. So it play a very vast role. So therefore, these were the all functions carried out by the pineal gland. The next gland which plays a very important role in the body development, okay, and the functions is the thyroid gland. The next important gland is the thyroid gland. Okay, this gland was discovered by Thomas Warton. It was discovered by Thomas Warton, and it is considered to be the largest gland of the body. Believing that the liver is not considered to be the gland. Believing that the liver is not a gland. Okay, so it was discovered by Thomas Warton and considered to be the largest gland of the body. It would be H shaped in nature. It would be H shaped. Okay, and consisting of size of 5 × 2, that is 5 length, 5 breadth, and 2 cm is its diameter. Okay, thickness. So weighing around 24 gram, it will be weighing around 24 gram. And in the case of females, it will be comparatively bigger in size. It will be bigger in size in the case of females. So the thyroid gland has got this specific structures and will be comparatively bigger in size in the case of females. Okay. So you can see this shows the H shaped. Here we can say H shaped. Okay. And that is responsible for secretion of the thyroxine. Thyroxine can be in different forms, T1, T2, T3, T4. Okay, T4 is exactly the functional thyroxine part, that is tetraiodothyronine. The one will be called as monoiodothyronine, T1. T2 is called as diiodothyronine. Thyronine is an amino acid, to which here we can see the structure also. If not there. Thyronine is the amino acid where the iodine will be attached. Okay, then it's called monoiodothyronine. Diiodothyronine when 2 iodines are present. Triiodothyronine when 3 are there. And tetraiodothyronine when 4. T3 and T4 are the functional in nature. T3 and T4 are functional in nature. Where the T3 is the one which is most efficient, but having very small lifespan. Having more efficiency, but less lifespan. And T4 having high efficiency, high lifespan, and efficiency quite good. Okay, and it's H-shaped. Okay, present near to the larynx. In the case of female, it is larger in size. Okay, in the case of female, it is larger in size. Now let us see. So mainly present the ventral surface of the larynx. Let us see the structure of the gland, structure of the thyroid gland. So single lobe in reptiles, in the case of reptiles, it is single, but in the case of humans, it is basically two lobes are present. In the case of humans, two lobes of thyroid glands are present. This is one lobe and this is the second lobe. Okay. both lobes are interconnected with a thin flap of connective tissue called as isthmus. So these both lobes are connected with a thin flap tissue called as isthmus. So this is the isthmus. Over here we can see this is the isthmus. This is connecting this right and left lobes of the thyroid gland, which is connecting this right and left lobe of the thoracic thyroid gland. Okay. Now each lobe have many thyroid follicles and the stromal tissues. So this is the thyroid follicle. Okay. So each lobe will be having many number of this thyroid follicle and this stromal tissue. This is basically stromal tissues, okay, and which will be having this thyroid follicle. Okay, and this thyroid follicle will be having this glandular cells present at this border periphery, okay, and the thyronin or thyroglobulin will be present in the center. This follicle will be consisting the glandular cells at its periphery, while it will be consisting this thyronin or thyroglobulin, it's a protein, okay, present in the center. Now what happens? Each follicle is lined by a cuboidal globular cells. Each follicle is lined by the cuboidal glandular cells, follicular epithelium, or we can say acinal cells also. These glandular cells present on the lining of this follicle. This glandular cells present on the lining of this follicle is called as cuboidal glandular follicular epithelium, or we can also call them as acinal cells. So what are acinal cells? They are the glandular cells present on the epithelium of the follicle. Okay, and it will be surrounding a gelatinous material. It will be basically surrounding a gelatinous material, which is called as colloid. Okay, which is called as colloid. So this part in the center of this follicle is called as colloid, which is gelatin in nature, and it is inactive thyroglobulin. Okay, so the follicle will be consisting the glandular epithelium at the surrounding, which will be having this, which will be also called as acinal cell, which are also called as acinal cells, and in center of this follicle they will be having inactivated thyroglobulin, which is called as colloid and is gelatinous in nature. Now the group of endocrine cells are found between the thyroid follicle and connective tissue. Those are called as parafollicular cells or C cells. Okay, so there will be some specific cells called as C cells, which are found. These are the endocrine cells and found between the thyroid follicles. So there are a lot of thyroid follicles present over here in a single thyroid gland. In each lobe there will be number of this type of thyroid follicles will be present, and between these thyroid follicles there will be a group of endocrine cells called as C cells are present, called as parafollicular cells, and these C cells will be secreting a calcitonin or thyrocalcitonin hormone. So we have got two types of hormones which are basically secreted from this thyroid gland, that is the thyroid iodine, or we can say thyroxine, and the calcitonin. Okay, so the thyroglobulin, or we can say the follicular cells, will be secreting this thyroxine. We'll see how it is secreting. While the cells present between this follicular cells are called as C cells, which are secreting the calcitonin, or we can say thyrocalcitonin hormone. Okay, now the major hormones secreted by thyroid gland are, so the iodine is essential for the normal rate of the hormone synthesis in the thyroid gland. So these are mainly two types of hormones, which are triiodothyronin, okay, and the second is tetraiodothyronin. So iodine plays a very important role for the synthesis of the both type of hormones, triiodothyronin and the tetraiodothyronin. Okay, so apart from this, these are the two hormones which are secreted by the gland, which are secreted by the thyroid gland. Okay, let us see the structure. This is the structure. Okay, so each lobe has many thyroid follicles and stromal tissues, and each follicle is lined by the cuboidal glandular follicular epithelium of we can say acinal cells, and surrounds a gelatinous material called as colloid, which is inactive thyroglobulin. So here this is a follicle which is lined by this glandular cells called as acinal cells, and in the center of this glandular cells we have got the thyroglobulin, which is inactive in nature, and this structure is called as gelatinous structure is called as colloid. Okay, now the group of endocrine cells are also found in between these thyroid follicles. So each lobe will be consisting lot of many number of thyroid follicles, in between which the C cells are present, and these C cells are responsible for secretion of calcitonin. We can also call that as thyrocalcitonin hormone. Okay, and these hormones which are released from this thyroid glands are the triiodothyronin, that is the T3, and tetraiodothyronin, that is the T4. Okay, so let us see the second hormone, that is thyrocalcitonin. Thyrocalcitonin. Okay, so thyrocalcitonin is basically produced due to the stimulus of the TSH. Okay, crinophagy of thyroglobulin occurs through the lysosome. Okay, so mainly these hormones are produced through by TSH under the effect of TSH, that is thyrostimulating hormone. Crinophagy of thyroglobulin occurs through the lysosome. So it will be basically this crinophagy is the the breaking down of this structures of this follicles, okay, with the help of lysosome. Okay, now then the thyroid hormone releases into blood. So due to this breaking down of vesicles, what will happen, this follicular cells which are present in the glands over here, the glandular cells present over here will be getting broken down or will be getting eaten up, we can say, with the help of lysosome. The lysosome will be breaking this down, and this content of this cells will be secreted out into the blood, will be secreting out directly into the blood, and hence it is an endocrine gland. Okay, so this will be releasing the hormones directly into the blood, which will be of again different types, that is triiodothyronin secreted around 4 mg per day, okay, and tetraiodothyronin, that is T4, secreted around 100 mg per day. And when we say they both, the T3 is around 4 times more effective than the T4. So T3 is the more active form of the thyroxine and compared to the T4. So T3 hormone is a more active form of thyroxine. It's more active form of thyroxine, okay, compared to the T4. So T4 will be secreted around 100 mg per day, while the T3 is secreted around 4 mg per day. Okay. Now it is the hormone is mainly responsible for control of BMR. And it stimulates the cell oxidation. So BMR, it's the basal metabolic rate. It's basically the minimum energy requirement for the normal functioning of body. In male is 40 calorie per minute, okay, or we can say 2000 kilocalorie per day. So what is BMR? The basal metabolic rate, which is the basic rate of the metabolism which is taking place inside the body for the survival of the organism. That is the BMR, that is basal metabolic rate of an organism. Okay, the BMR in the case of female is 37.5 calorie per minute, and the case of male it is 40 calorie per minute. Okay, in the case of female it is quite small, lower, that is 37.5 calorie per minute. This thyroxine will be also helping in the metamorphosis. Metamorphosis is a process where the transformation of an organism will occur from one type to another structure. It's a structural change is taking place in the organism during the development. So what is metamorphosis? It's the structural changes which are taking place inside the organism during its development. Example, when the frog is basically at its younger stage, it will be forming the tadpoles. The tadpoles will be having the gills for the respiration, and it will be also having the tails present in it. Okay, so this tadpole will be now getting converted into an adult frog. Where the gills will be absent, the tails will be absent. Okay, so this changing in the structure during the growth, changing in the structure during the development is called as metamorphosis. And this metamorphosis is the one which is responsible, which requires this hormone thyroxine. This thyroxine plays a very important role in the metamorphosis. So frog becomes adult because it helps in the cell differentiation. So it will be responsible for metamorphosis, or we can say cell differentiation. So metamorphosis is a changing the structure of organism during the development phase. Okay, that is metamorphosis, and it is also responsible for differentiation of the cell. It means the cell will be differentiating with different types of cell to carry out a specific function of that particular cell. It is called as differentiation. Okay. Now they are also responsible for supporting the process of red blood cell formation. So that is called the hemopoiesis. Hemopoiesis means it is responsible for the formation of the red blood cells. RBC will be formed. Erythrocyte will be generated. Okay. Okay. Then next is the control the metabolism of the carbohydrate. Different nutrient substances which are taken up by the body for the basic requirement of carrying out the metabolic reactions and forming the energy. So this metabolism of these all compounds like carbohydrates, proteins, and fats would be under the control of this thyroid gland. Okay, so the thyroxine will be responsible for metabolism of carbohydrate, protein, and fats. Thyroid gland also secrete a protein hormone called as thyrocalcitonin. It's also secreting a hormone called as thyrocalcitonin, which regulates the blood calcium levels. This will be responsible for regulating the blood calcium levels. Okay, So it will be playing a very important role in the, this thyroxine will be also playing a very important role in the mental and physical and sexual development of the gonads. So it is also responsible for development of mental development of a body, physical development, and the even the sexual development of the gonads. So it is also responsible for when during the condition of the pregnancy, if the mother body is not having the sufficient amount of thyroxine, that may lead to the different type of complications in the embryo, and then embryo will be developing in improper manner, and hence it may lead to the improper development, mental development or physical development of the child. So that has to be supplemented with the proper amount of iodine so that the proper amount of thyroxine can be synthesized. Okay, and it increases or stimulates the gluconeogenesis. This thyroxine hormone will be responsible for stimulating the gluconeogenesis, that is the formation of the glucose. So it is basically hyperglycemic hormone which will be increasing the increasing the glucose concentration in the blood. So the hormones which are basically increasing the concentration of glucose in the blood is called as hyperglycemic, while the one which is decreasing the glucose concentration of blood is called as hypoglycemic. So this is the one which will be increasing the concentration of glucose in the blood. So that is about the thyroid gland, the structure of thyroid gland. Then we have seen the structure of thyroid gland and the internal structure of thyroid gland consisting the follicle, thyroglobulin, and the colloid, which will be having this lined by this glandular epithelium cells. These cells will be filled with, will be containing the hormones, and these cells will be crinophaged by the lysosome present over there, and then it will secrete into blood. And it will be in different forms, T1, T2, T3, T4, where the T3 and T4 are the main forms, which are basically functional in nature. T3 is more efficient, around 4 times more active compared to T4, but secreted in less amount. T4 is secreted in high amount, that is around 100 mg per day. T3 is less stable compared to the T4. Okay, it is responsible for controlling the BMR, and it's in different energy level which is required by the male and female is also given. We have seen that it is responsible for the metabolism of the fats, carbohydrates and proteins and all that nutrient substances in the body. And it also responds for metamorphosis, which is the transformation of the body structure during the development. Okay, now it also plays an important role in the physical, mental and sexual development of the embryo during the development of its body. And it increases or stimulates the gluconeogenesis, or we can say it's a hyperglycemic hormone. Okay, so it is responsible for growth of the physical growth, that is skeletal, muscular and visceral growth of the body. It is also responsible for sexual growth by the growth of the gonads, and is also responsible for the mental growth. So it is very important, it plays a very important role in the growth of a organism. Regulation of thyroid hormone secretion. So as we know that thyroid hormone will be secreted under the effect of the thyroid stimulating hormone, Now this is the thyroid gland. It will be secreting this hormone, which is responsible for the increasing the thyroid hormone level. Okay, now this, when this thyroid hormone level is increased, that is T3, T4 level is increased, what will happen? It will go and bind to the thyroid gland. It will bind to the anterior pituitary part of the thyroid gland. It will bind to the anterior pituitary part of the thyroid gland, where it will inhibit the secretion of this thyroid gland. Okay, it is also regulated by the circadian rhythm. Now this thyroid gland will be responsible for, it will be acting under the effect of the thyrotropin. So when it will be affecting the thyrotropin releasing hormone will be secreted by this hypothalamus, and due to which the anterior pituitary will be responsible for releasing the TSH. So when the TSH level is high, what will happen? This TRH will be basically again inhibiting this hypothalamus for the formation of TSH. So these are basically different mode of regulating the thyroid hormone secretion in the human body. Okay, now let us see the effects of deficiency, or we can say hypothyroidism, when the thyroid hormone, or we can say the thyroxine, is present in it's absent, it is although absent from the body or blood, or we can say it is present but in the scarcity, it is present but in the lack, it is small amount, not enough for the different functions. So that is called as deficiency, or we can say hypothyroidism. So it mainly occurs due to deficiency of the iodine, because we know that the iodine is one of the important part responsible, important element required for the synthesis of the thyroxine. So in the deficiency of the iodine, it will be responsible for the decreasing amount of the T4 and T3, which are the functional form of thyroxine. Okay, So when the iron concentration is low, or the iodine concentration is low, there will be decreasing amount of formation of T3 and T4, and this will be responsible for even causing the disturbance in the irregular menstrual cycle in the case of female. So it will be responsible for different type of complications and different type of problems may arises. Few of them are following. Okay, like it will be decreasing. It will be decreasing or making the menstrual cycle irregular in the case of females. Okay. Now following diseases are characterized by hypothyroidism. So hypothyroidism will be basically will be responsible for different diseases, like first one, the creatinism. Creatinism is the one which is where the low amount of iodine present in the child development. The child development will be not occurring properly due to the low amount of the iodine present in the their nutrient substances. Okay, so that would cause the mental retardation. Okay, that will be causing the mental retardation or improper development of the improper mental growth of the organism, and that will be responsible for mental retardation and dwarf condition. The body will not be basically developed properly. Such condition called a dwarf condition. Okay, so creatinism will be responsible for mental retardation of the organism and dwarf condition of the body. It will be responsible for low intelligence quotient. The IQ of the body, IQ of the person, individual will be low, and the skin will be abnormal and will be showing the depth where the person will not be able to see or will not be able to listen the things, and it will not be able to even speak anything. So deaf and mutism is also basically observed due to this creatinism. In this, the heart rate decreases, the low blood pressure, the blood pressure of the body will be low, and the body appear cold. So creatinism, main signs and symptoms are first physical symptoms, second mental, and the third is sexual. The physical symptoms, you can say the skeletal muscles will not be developed, and hence it is dwarf. Okay, it will be dwarf in condition. Muscular growth is not possible, not proper, and hence the muscles are weak muscles. Okay, which may get degenerated. And then the viscerals, not so retarded, hence protuberance. So the visceral development is normal, so we cannot say that much difference in the visceral growth. And mental growth is basically, it's basically not found proper. So we can say idiocy, or because IQ is low and mental retardation is basically found. Okay, and the sexual growth. So infertile sex, so the sex characters are not exactly seen properly. No secondary sex characters are observed. So it will be retarding this physical growth, mental growth, and sexual growth in different proportion. So that is the main sign and symptoms found in the creatinism. Next is the myxoedema. Next is myxoedema, is also called as Gull's disease. It's also a type of hypothyroidism where the amount of T3, T4 is less. And the creatinism was the condition which is found in mainly the child. Okay, the creatinism was the main condition which was found in the child, and that was occurring due to the insufficient amount of iodine in the nutrients during the child's birth. Okay, and it mainly during the child's birth or during the pregnancy. Now myxoedema is the one which is found the deficiency of the T4 and T3 in the adult, due to the deficiency of T4 and T3 in the adult. Now this is mainly due to the deposition of the myxomatous tissue, that the mucopolysaccharide will be deposited in this gland, near to the gland, and due to which what will happen, the myxoedema, or we can say myxomatous tissue, or the mucopolysaccharides will be deposited in this gland. Okay, and this, due to this, what will happen? So due to deposition of this tissue, the puffiness on the face and the neck occurs due to collection of water, due to which the water will be collected in this face part and the neck. Okay, and hence it will be occurring, the puffiness of the face will be seen, and the person will be feeling cold, and the heart rate will be decreasing, the blood pressure will also decreases, and the hypokinetic movement will occur. Hypokinetic movement is the one, basically the movement of the the movement of the body part. Okay, so the body part will be less, and inability to concentrate, the person will not be able to concentrate properly. So these are the different symptoms found in the myxoedema. Okay, again, this is decreasing the T3 and T4 in the adults. Next, the endemic goiter or simple goiter. Endemic goiter or the simple goiter. So goiter is basically the it mainly occurs due to deficiency of the iodine. So here what will happen, the goiter is the enlargement of this thyroid gland. Enlargement of the thyroid gland will occur. So this is called as goiter. What is goiter? It's the enlargement of the thyroid gland. So due to the deficiency of iodine, what will happen? Synthesis of iodine decreases.
synthesis of thyroid hormone decreases. Now, due to the low level of, it may be of different due to different reasons. It may be endemic, that is, it's localized in a particular area where the amount of iodine is not found properly. So, in some cases, what may happen? The iodine will not be found properly in that particular localized region. So, due to which the synthesis of hormone will not be taking place properly. So, that may lead to the formation of, that may lead to the condition of goiter. Now, low level of thyroid hormone causes the increased secretion of TSH. So, when the thyroid hormone is low, so under the effect of the feedback mechanism, the TSH will be increased. And due to this TSH, this TSH will be stimulating the thyroid follicle to secrete thyroid hormone. And continuous stimulation of TSH causes the enlargement of thyroid gland. And this enlargement is called as goiter. So, the thyroid hormones is not secreted, but the TSH will be continuously secreted. Due to which, what will happen? The thyroid hormone follicles will be, thyroid follicles will be enlarged. Okay, and due to which the whole thyroid gland will be enlarged. And this structure is called as goiter. This enlargement of the thyroid gland is called as goiter. Okay. Next is the Hashimoto's disease. Hashimoto's disease is an immunothyroiditis. Immunothyroiditis. In this case, the thyroid gland, the autoantibodies, the antibodies will be secreted against our own body itself. So the body will not be able to recognize the self and non-self part of the body, and hence what will happen, the body will be starting synthesizing the antibodies against the thyroid gland itself. So the antibody, the body will start synthesizing the antibodies against the thyroid hormone itself, and hence the thyroglobulin, the cells of thyroid follicles will be destroyed. So due to the antibodies which are secreted, which are formed against the thyroid hormone, thyroglobulin and the cells of thyroid follicles, what will happen, the thyroid gland is destroyed by the antibodies, and this destruction will be leading to the inflammation of the thyroid gland, and that is also called as suicide of thyroid. That's also called as suicide of thyroid, and will be leading to the Hashimoto's disease. So Hashimoto's disease is a type of autoimmunity disorder. Autoimmunity disorder where the antibodies are secreted, antibodies are formed by our own body against the thyroid gland. Okay, that will be killing the or destroying the thyroid gland, causing the suicide of the thyroid. Next is the hyperthyroidism. So hyperthyroidism is a condition where the level of thyroid hormone is increased. The level of thyroid hormone is increased compared to the normal condition, and it may occur due to the cancerous growth of the thyroid gland. It may occur mainly due to the cancerous growth of thyroid gland, or maybe due to the development of nodules of the thyroid glands. Maybe due to the development of the nodules of the thyroid glands. So it can be of different types. It can be of different type. That is Graves' disease. In the case of Graves' disease, mainly the protrusion of the eyeball occur. What will happen? The protrusion of the eyeball occur. It means the eyeball will be, the eyeball, the growth of eyeball will be enlarged, and it will come outside the what you can say eyeball. Okay, so the protrusion of eyeball occur due to deposition of the mucus behind the eyeball. So the eyeball will be basically coming out of the eyeball cavity. Okay, and hence it will be observed as a protruded. Okay, and because the mucus will be secreted and deposited in the backside of this behind the eyeball. It is called as exophthalmos condition. This condition is called as exophthalmos. What we can say, when the eyeball is just coming outside the cavity, it's called as exophthalmos condition. Exophthalmic goiter is the main symptom of this disease. Exophthalmic goiter is the main symptoms of this disease. Other symptoms are blood pressure, insomnia, okay, anxiety, and which happens in this particular condition. So these are the different types of disease related to the thyroid gland, that is hyperthyroidism and the hyperthyroidism. Next is the parathyroid gland. Let us finish this one as well. So parathyroid gland is also called as Kolb gland. It's also called as Kolb gland, where basically four number, or we can say two pairs of parathyroid glands are present. Okay, so there are two pairs of four in number of parathyroid gland. Each lobe of thyroid gland have one pair of parathyroid gland at the posterior side. So we have got two lobes of thyroid gland, and each lobe will be consisting two number of parathyroid gland, and hence total number is 4. The parathyroid gland secretes a peptide hormone called as parathyroid hormone, PTH. So it will be secreting the specific hormone called as PTH, or called as parathyroid hormone. The secretion of PTH is regulated by circulating level of calcium ions in the blood. So the calcium ions that are present in the blood will be responsible for regulating the PTH. And it is secreted in response to decreased blood calcium levels. So whenever the blood calcium level, that calcium present in the blood is decreased, whenever the calcium present in the blood decreased, it will be responsible for secreting this PTH. Now this PTH stimulates the activity of osteoclast cells. Osteoclast cells are the one which are responsible for increasing the calcium level by by taking the calcium from the bones.
Okay. So this PTH, whenever this calcium level is whenever the calcium level is decreased in the blood, PTH is secreted, and this PTH will be responsible for stimulating the osteoclast cell activity, and it will dissolve the bone and releases the calcium into the blood. So the osteoclast will be the cells. Osteoclast cell will be dissolving the blood, dissolving the bone, and will be responsible for increasing the calcium concentration, calcium ion concentration in the blood, and decreasing the PO4. So in hypercalcemic hormone, it's a hypercalcemic hormone which is responsible for increasing the calcium concentration, And when the concentration of calcium is retained or is basically higher in the blood, the stimulation or the secretion of PTH will be decreased. Okay. So it is mainly responsible for increasing the blood calcium level. Hyperparathyroidism, in the condition of hyperparathyroidism, what happens? The PTH level is increased, and which will be responsible for causing the osteoporosis. Due to the high amount of PTH, what will happen? The calcium will be getting dissolved in the blood by the dissolving the bone by the osteoclastic activity. So when the PTH is high, the osteoclast cells will be starting to dissolve the bone and release the more amount of ion concentration of iron, calcium ions, due to which the osteoporosis will occur and the bones will become weaker and become fragile due to the lack of the calcium ion. Okay, it is called as osteic fibrosis fibrous cystica. This condition is called as where due to high PTH the osteoporosis occurs and the bones become fragile. This condition is called as osteic fibrous cystica. And more chances of forming of renal stones due to this high amount of calcium concentration in the blood. What may happen? This calcium will be then filtered out, okay, and into the kidney, where they may get deposited in the kidney, forming the renal stones. So the high amount of calcium would be responsible for forming the renal stones in the kidney particularly. Okay. Next is the hypoparathyroidism. It's a low level of parathyroid hormone leads to hypercalcemia, which is a tetany. So when the calcium concentration is high, sorry, when the PTH is low, so in the low level of PTH, what will happen? The concentration of calcium will be low in the case of in the blood, and that will lead to the tetany condition, where the body will start, the moving muscles will start contracting, or we can say it will be inability to relax. So the contraction relaxation of the muscle is basically taken care or regulated by the calcium concentration in the muscle fiber. So when the muscles does not have the proper amount of concentration of calcium, it will lead to the improper contraction relaxation, which will be called as tetany. Okay, and this will be due to the low amount of PTH. Okay, so that was about the hormone PTH. So we have done the different hormones which were secreted by the anterior pituitary, then the posterior pituitary, and their functions are seen. Next, we have seen the hormones secreted by the thyroid gland, the structure of thyroid gland, the hormones secreted by thyroid gland, the disorders associated with thyroid gland, and then the PTH, parathyroid hormone, the secretion, and the disorders associated to it. Okay, that's all for right now. In the next lecture, we'll be starting another hormone, that is the gland, that is thymus, and then we'll be starting the other hormones and the functions as well. That's all. Thank you for being. Bye-bye. Have a nice day.